So we've been looking in this Computerphile and the previous one at how, when we press a key on a keyboard, what actually happens to from that key press being pressed in the physical hardware to the software, say Microsoft Word, displaying that on screen. And in the previous episode, if you haven't seen, I suggest you click the link here and go and watch now. We saw what happened to the hardware side of things. So we sort of left our story where the hardware, and we saw how that, depending on what it thinks these days, that'll get packaged up into a serial message which is sent to a specialist port, has interrupted the CPU, and now we're looking at the sort of the software side of things of what the operating system does to actually make this work. Just like there was many layers in the hardware, there's many layers in the software. So the first place we need to look in a modern operating system, and I should caveat this by saying I'm going to be talking in general terms. Each operating system, whether that's Windows, Linux, macOS, probably even CPM for people like Sean, we're going to talk in general. So yes, there'll be some operating systems which do something different. There'll be some which merge some steps. There'll be some that expand some steps. Fight about it in the comments. So the first thing that there will be from this side is that the hardware's interrupted. There'll be a bit of software built into the operating system which actually handles that interrupt. And we'll probably map it to the right bit of software to handle where the which bit of hardware has generated it. And eventually something of that will handle, this is a keyboard interrupt mapped through whatever is the USB, the Bluetooth, the direct connection, depending on how it works, and says, okay, there's been a keyboard interrupt. I know how to handle this sort of thing, and I'm then going to do it. So it'll get the data and it'll say, okay, this key was pressed. Let's say the letter A was pressed or the letter A was released. You generally will get messages from the keyboard to say the key's been pressed and a message to say that the key's been released. So that then will get received by the device driver. And these generally don't actually need to be that complicated. You generally find if you look at the code, say in the Linux kernel, because it's open source, that the keyboard software for a simple keyboard, like on something like the Atari ST or the Falcon, it just reads from a memory location. It's relatively straightforward. Of course, if you've got a USB or Bluetooth keyboard, then you've got to implement the whole USB and Bluetooth stacks. Things are a lot more complicated, but that's the point of the device driver. It can handle all that, abstracts it away from your program as a user. You just say what key's been pressed. Okay, so we've got that data. We're now in software. We know this key has been pressed. What happens then? Well, you generally don't have your software, say your word processor, talk directly to that device driver. Partly because you'd have to write it for every single possible different device driver you might need. You've got a USB keyboard or a Bluetooth one, whatever it is, and so on. You get the point. So what actually happens is that inside, say, a modern operating system, there's a way of handling input devices, keyboards, mice, buttons on your machine and so on that will handle these things. And so when the keyboard device driver detects a key press, it sends that message, or as it generally is termed by that point, an event, to the relevant input device which has been created for that particular keyboard. The other advantage of this is that you can have multiple keyboards connected to your computer quite easily, and you can read them separately. You don't always have to, but you could do that if you wanted to. So you'd have some sort of event queue inside your operating system that will, and remember this is inside the operating system kernel, so this is not talking about graphical user interface or anything at this point, we're just talking about getting the message from device driver into the user land where our programs are running. And when the key's pressed, it would send an event down that, it would place an event into that queue saying, this key was pressed, this is what the scan code was. You could at that point convert that to ASCII, that'll probably actually happen later in the stack, probably happen in user mode. There's no reason for it to be done there, but it could be done inside the kernel and so on. And the less you do inside the kernel, the less attack surface you got from a security point of view. You probably timestamp it so you know when that happened and so on. And you put that into the queue. And if we imagine this as a boundary in your software between what we call user mode, which is where our programs run, and kernel mode, which is where the stuff that wants to talk to the hardware and the actual things that keep things in control. And somewhere on there, you'll have some sort of transfer port, and our event queue for the inputs would come from the device driver, which gets the message from the keyboard, and the software would pop it into the event queue. And then when the program over here read from that, it would pull the first one off and get the message to say this key was pressed or this key was released. So we're now out of the kernel, we're out of hardware, we've gone through the device driver in the kernel, we've gone through the kernel's input queues, and we're now in user mode. And the software can ask what key has been pressed. Now, if this was a command line process, it would actually probably be talking to what's called a pseudo teletype or a teletype type interface in something like Linux or Unix, which literally emulate the old sort of teletype printers and keyboards and so on. And the conversion from scan codes to ASCII would be handled at that point in the implementation of the teletype terminal. For a graphical user interface, things tend to have a few more stages in there. So what you'll generally have is a program, so on something like a Mac, for example, you have a program called Windows Server, and there's equivalent things, X, for example, on Linux and in Windows, which handles the whole graphical user interface. So that's sitting there, producing the displays, working out which window's active and so on. And it will be that point of the software stack that will get the key presses from the operating system. So that part of it, the Windows Server, let's just use that as a term, will get the key presses. And then it will look to say, okay, I've got this key press, A's been pressed. Where do I actually send this to? Which window is receiving this? Is it the Word processor, Word running on this, or is it going into the email client, or is it going into a Signal to send a secure text message, or wherever it is it's going? Where's it got to go? And it knows which window is active, so it'll then say, okay, this is going to this window is active. We need to send this to this program. Now, how does that happen? Well, again, it's similar to what happens here. Every graphical user interface program generally has at its heart an event processing, message processing loop. And basically the way they work, it's sometimes explicit. You sometimes have to code it. So if you program Windows around 20 years ago, you would write code which would have things like peek message, translate message, dispatch message, I'm not remembering the names right, functions in a tight loop to handle all those things. If you're writing code on a Acorn Archimedes, you would call swy wimp poll and so on to do this to get the messages. And basically you call that in a loop and then you get a message and dispatch it. These days it tends to get wrapped up and things, so it's actually hidden in library code and things, but generally it's still doing the same thing. So the Windows Server will send an event to your program saying a key has been pressed in this window. And so on, it'll happen. And again, that by that point, we've probably converted it. So we've still got the scan code there, but we've probably also converted it into the ASCII code or the Unicode code as well. That will be handled by the Windows Server because it can then localize it and do whatever it's needed, knowing what sort of keyboard you've got connected. And so then there's ways that these can be automatically configured. So you don't actually have to physically tell it unless you want to. So the Windows Server will package it up. And at this point, it won't use the same sort of event format that the kernel use. It could, but generally there's probably a more specific one which is tied into which windows and things are being used. That's then got into your program and you say, hey, let's say with Microsoft Word, he's pressed the A key. You then need to do in your program whatever you need to do in your program to update your data structures to say that whatever document we had before, we now need to put an A at wherever the current cursor is in that. And that depends on how your program's written. If you're a game and that you've got WASD for controlling movement and you press A, well, then you want to update where the player or the camera's position is on the screen. At that point, once we're into the user code, the user program that we're interacting with, what happens is up to how the program works. It may be that it does absolutely nothing because it doesn't respond to that key. That's a simple case. At that point, we don't know what's happening. It's a black box. It's the program. But we said then what happens, at that point we still haven't updated the screen. We've pressed the key and it's gone, and it may be that there's no visual effect from pressing that key. You could write a program where that didn't happen and then 2 hours later it popped up a picture of Tom and Jerry on the screen to surprise you if you pressed the wrong key. Probably not going to write a program like that, but you could. What's going to happen? Well, we still need to redraw the screen. So what will happen inside, say, the word presser, you press the A key, we've updated the data structures to say we've now got an A in our document. We will then finally say we want to redraw the current window that's representing that document. And what that'll actually probably be, it probably won't draw it then and there. What it'll probably do is tell the Windows Server that this window needs redrawing, and then eventually that will then come and redraw it. And the reason why that happens is that actually the window may be redrawing anyway, because you've moved the screen or whatever it is, you've brought that to the front. And actually you can then combine the redraws and speed things up a little bit. And that's pretty much the story of what happens when you press a key on a computer. It's quite involved. What's fascinating, though, is I read an article that actually measured the latency, the time it takes from you pressing a key on a keyboard to it appearing or having an effect on the screen. And actually, on modern computer systems, whether it's Windows, Mac, or Linux, it's incredibly long compared to what it was like on something like the Apple II or the BBC Micro behind me. On the Apple II or the BBC Micro, it effectively did it on the next frame redraw within 30 milliseconds. On a modern PC, it is significantly longer than that.
Are all keys treated equally? Shift, Control, A, B, C, are they all the same? Number one, keypad, F key?
So that's a very good question. Are all keys treated equally? The short answer is yes, and the long answer is no. It depends where you get up to. So implementation of the keyboard, the shift keys, the caps lock key, the num lock key, all handled identically. Obviously, some of them have LEDs associated with them to light up when they're pressed or not. Generally, the computer will tell the keyboard to light those LEDs or not light those LEDs. So you press the key and the computer sends a message back. That could be implemented in the keyboard. It depends on the implementation. So at the hardware level, they're probably identical. In the kernel, they're probably identical. I think it'd probably be when you get to the point of the Windows server or the actual command line teletype terminal that it would actually be handled. And again, if you actually look at the implementation of the operating systems, you can find out what modifier keys are pressed. You generally don't get events for those keys. You only get events being passed to say that a key's been pressed. But when you get that event, you can say, oh, shift's pressed as well, or shift's not pressed. And so you can work out what's going on. So the answer is yes and no.
That time when I was playing Manic Miner and I jumped and I hit the key, I had jumped. It was the computer that got it wrong, right?
Possibly, it depends what the way it was implemented and things. I'm not going to comment on your game playing ability, particularly as you had a Commodore 64.